Thanks a lot. Appreciate it. Well, how are y'all doing this afternoon? It's always good to be back to my alma mater here. And it's always a pleasant view coming over the bridge, seeing my old set of quarters there out at Fort Adams. I always had a $20,000 house on a $1 million lot. And then the War College is here. For you Army folks out there, you should rest well at night. I think we were just talking at lunch. I think four of the Army's currently sitting four-star generals or Navy War College graduates, to include the Chief of Staff of the Army and the Vice Chief of Staff of the Army. So, as I always say, at least, I know for sure the Army values a Navy War College education greatly, as I'm sure the other services do. So it's great to be able to come back here and talk to you about kind of a number of things. I'll cover a broad swath of topics, but hopefully have a point of continuity through them. And since here at the War Colleges, we like to focus on strategic topics and sort of at the strategic level, that will also be one of the things that I focus on, kind of bringing you back there and how the Army is thinking about it within the joint context, what we think some of the challenges are, and how we are going about doing that. The first thing I'll do, though, is kind of contextualize sort of my role in the Army, and so you can have an idea of why it is I'm talking about the things I'm talking about, and then also maybe to generate questions. And so I tell folks, one of the things that leaders do is they contextualize the environment they're operating in. They contextualize the environment that their organization operates in, and they contextualize the environment of what they want specifically their folks to do in that. So I find, as I go around the country and even our Army in the world, one of the things I have to contextualize is, what is training and doctrine command? You know, what is training and doctrine command? What is it for? I always tell folks, figure out first what you are for before you decide what you do. Those are two different things. And so, even the folks inside the Army, because they're familiar with certain parts of TRADOC, but maybe not the rest of it. I don't have too many slides, and since I'm a former armor officer, most of them are pictures. And I really hate to even have a line and block diagram, but to sort of give you the clarity of training, doctrine, command, I do find that is probably the most useful way of doing it. And of course, you don't get credit for a military briefing unless there's a line and block diagram in it, so you all get full credit today. So if you can put up the first slide, so this is intuitively obvious here. As I say, as I go around the world, no other Army has a training and doctrine command. In fact, none of the other services do. The Marines, the Navy, the Air Force, etc. So that means one of two things. Either we're off base, and TRADOC is nothing but excessive overhead, or maybe it's working right at least for us. You don't have to answer me at least publicly now whether or not you think your service or your nation has a right not having a TRADOC, or whether the Army might be onto something. But let me kind of talk you through what training and doctrine command does for our Army, what it's for, and then maybe it might be clear. So one of the things, let me kind of walk through the big pieces here. So we have, you know, the bloated command group structure up there, like every organization does, and you know, I have myself and the Sergeant Major and drivers and various things like that. And then as we sort of come down here, there's a couple of major components of it. One is Army Capabilities Integration Center. They really do the futures work for the Army. I'm going to come back to that. In fact, I was having a conversation at lunch as we're approaching this with the joint aspect. I'm trying to get a clear idea of how the Navy and Air Force and Marines do it, so I'm plugged into them, as well as our coalition partners. That's under the able leadership of Lieutenant General H.R. McMaster. He's an institution even in himself, a great asset for the Army, well-published author, and he really does the future work. We have some niche capabilities here, asymmetric warfare group and rapid equipping force. It gets stuff into the field very quickly. These came about because of our IED threat in Iraq. Initially, they used to work for Department of the Army, and now they've been moved down to Training and Doctrine Command. I'll come back to that. Then we have Combined Arms Center. This is out at Fort Leavenworth. And really, Lieutenant General Bob Brown out there, a Navy War College graduate, by the way. What he does is he does a number of things. For one thing, he really owns all of our branch school structure in the Army. So the intelligence school, the aviation center, so he trains all our pilots, all our tank drivers, our artillerymen, our cyber people, anything. If you are going to school in the United States Army, that all resolves down here. These are called centers of excellence. And then you can see all the branches, aviation, air defense, armor, infantry, et cetera, MPs, chemical. They're all underneath the Combined Arms Center. They also do our lessons learned, and they write all of our doctrine out of the Combined Arms Center as well. And then over here, we have U.S. Army Recruiting Command. So when you drive around the country and you see Armed Forces Recruiting signs up there, you say, oh, that's Training and Doctrine Command. So TRADOC recruits the United States Army. U.S. Army Cadet Command, so we run ROTC for the Army, 300 schools and universities across the country. And then U.S. Army Center for Initial Military Training, that's all the basic training, advanced individual training, basic officer training, et cetera, like that. So that's sort of all under the Byzantine Empire of Training and Doctrine Command. So a lot of different things that are done by all the other services, but they do them in different places and with different people. The Army has kind of put them all into one big group. Now, right now, when you look at it, it says, you know, but it kind of looks like the island of misfit toys there. It's stuff that sort of nobody else wanted. It doesn't fit together because you got basic training, you have recruiting, you have ROTC, you have the future of the Army, you have helicopter pilots, you have cyber experts. Kinds of seem like the island of misfit toys. So let me kind of walk you through this, how it operates, and then I might be clear about why it is we're doing what we're doing with regards to our operating concept for the Army. One of the monikers that TRADOC has is we are the architect of the Army. So we design the future of the U.S. Army. And we do that right over here under the able leadership of Lieutenant General H.R. McMaster. And what we do is we look out to the future. We're looking out to 2025 to 2040. And we try to describe the environment that we're going to be operating in. And then once we describe the environment to 2025, 2040, we start coming up with the first order capabilities that the United States Army has to have as part of the joint force to deal with that future that we're describing. And then we write it via a concept. So the United States Army is a concept-based, doctrine-driven army. Not every army is, not every service is, but the United States Army is a concept-based, doctrine-driven army. So what they do is they write the concepts, which describes the operating environment. They describe the first order capabilities. And then we write in TRADOC all of the requirements for the Army. This is what we want a division to do. This is what we want a brigade to do. This is what we want helicopters to do. This is what we want tanks to do. And then all of the schools down here at the Aviation Center, Major General Mike Lundy, he is working on the next series of future vertical lift, for instance, for the U.S. Army. If you go down to the Maneuver Center of Excellence, you know, the armor and infantry, they're designing the next tank or the infantry fighting vehicle or whatever in accordance with the requirements that we have set about out here. So what happens is we write the requirements and then we start coming up with the first order capabilities, and they generally are capabilities that these people produce. So they start working with that, and then we start working with the Army staff to resource those capabilities, prioritize them, et cetera, like that, and through the joint process. So the first thing we do is we have to do a blueprint for the Army. But if you were going to build a house, there's a couple of ways to build a house. You can go to an architect and get a blueprint, or go to eplans.com and download a blueprint or whatever. You got the blueprint, and then you could, you know, you go out and hire a contractor. You say, okay, I want this. It's a three-bedroom, two-bath house. Hire a contractor, and then start building the house. Or you can go to a design-build firm that some of you may have used to build a house. It's kind of a turnkey operation. You walk in, you say, I want a three-bedroom, two-bath house. Design-build firm, one-stop shopping. They go, okay, we got it. You know, we're going to, you know, crank out the design, and then we'll build it for you. Come back in a year, we'll give you a key to the front door. That's really what Training and Doctrine Command is for the United States Army. We are a design-build firm. Okay, so we design the Army, and then instead of kind of subcontracting it out, then actually we start building it. So if you were a contractor building a house, the first thing you do is you get the blueprints. Okay, this is what I need. Get my Ford F-150 pickup truck, drive down to Home Depot and say, I need plywood, I need sheetrock, 2x4s, some screws, et cetera, like that. Come up with this whole bill of lading. Well, that's what these folks do here. come up with a blueprint for the army and say, I need an army this big. I need this many soldiers. I need this many officers. So these people start bringing in the raw materials. We go out and recruit the army that we sort of have designed. And we say, okay, this is the raw materials. We are a soldier-centric force. That is our main weapon system, soldiers. So they are the main acquisition part of the sort of the essence of the army. So recruiting command goes out and recruits the soldiers, and cadet command goes out and gets about 76% of the officer corps and brings them in. Boom, dumps them on the driveway at Trade Oak, said, hey, had the blueprint, here's all your soldiers, here's all your officers, what are you gonna do with it? Then what's the next thing we do? We start building it. And we give it to these folks here. And we send it to basic training, we send it to advanced individual training, we send it to basic officer course, et cetera. And we start building this, you know, frame of this two-bedroom or three-bedroom, two-bath house. We get it built out, framed, et cetera, like that. And then we give it to Forces Command, who makes ready the army in unit sets. Battalions, brigades, divisions. So it was General Milley, he's now our Chief Staff of the Army, now General Abe Abrams. And he makes ready the army. And then if the nation calls upon it, we give the army to combatant commanders and they fight the army. They fight the army for a while and they go, you know what, I want to improve the army. I want more lessons learned, I want more doctrine, I want more leader development techniques, etc. So what happens is they give it back to training doctrine command. And what do we do with it? We send it to the captain's career course. We send it to Command and General Staff College. We send it out to the Sergeant Major's Academy. We put them back in PME, give them more doctrine, give them more lessons learned, et cetera, like that. Boom, kick it back out to the force. Force Comm makes ready. Combatant commanders fight it. So what TRADOC really does is we design the army, we acquire the army, we build the army, and we improve the army. Force Comm makes ready the army, and combatant commanders fight the army. So if you are a Carlisle, that's a whole semester of the Army War College right there, how the Army works. So see, you guys will get credit for that as well. So what TRADOC does is we design the Army, we acquire the Army, we build the Army, and then we improve the Army. And it's done in one. So now you start taking a look at this, you say, okay, it doesn't look quite as much like the Island of Misfit Toys because it's all in here. You have the people that come up with the capabilities, that write the requirements, that acquire the requirements, that then improve the requirements and write the doctrine and train the doctrine on and on like that. And it's kind of one-stop shopping. So when the Chief of Staff of the Army says, I want a new army, he can point to one place and say, get me one. Go out and get me one. Because of that, we spend a lot of our time, especially right now, thinking about the future. What is the Army for? What role does the Army play and the joint construct, and then what is the U.S. military for? What is our nation going to be doing in the future? Because you've got to start working on this thing ahead of time. And so that's what we're doing right now. And so, as I said, we're a concept-based, doctrine-driven army, so we started off with a concept. If you go to the next slide. So this is kind of a pictorial version of it. And this is a manual we put out last year in October, you know, euphemistically known as TRADOC pamphlet 525-3-1. I'm sure you all know that. But more accurately described is the Army operating concept. This is the concept that we put out. We put them out whenever we think sort of the world is changing dramatically. We put this out last year. It's been out about a year. It's called Win in a Complex World. What we're saying is that the problem that we have to deal with. And what this does is it describes the future of the world. Doesn't predict it, two different things. It describes it, and then it describes the first order capabilities that we think the Army has to have within the joint construct, which then we start working through all the schools and centers and coming up with specific requirements to build the capability to accomplish what we're trying to do is win in a complex world. Now, let me walk you through a couple of things. This is a pictorial representation of, you know, a 40-page document there. But a couple of things come out. And the first thing I'll start with is the title there, Win in a Complex World. So since I'm the doctrine guy of the Army, I've come to find out that words have meanings. And what we like to do in the Army, since have words have meanings, is to take the word and give it a meaning and define it so that we don't talk past each other. So when I say attack or defeat or defend, we know what that means. So we don't have to get into a long discussion of it. That is the power of doctrine. A lot of people think doctrine is overly confining. Actually, I think it's fairly empowering. because we use our doctrine. I'll give some examples in it about how you think and talk about war, not specifically what you do all the time, but how do you think about it and how do you talk about it so that we get a common visualization and we have a common language to discuss it. But contrary to popular belief, it is not confining as to specifically the details of what you have to do in most cases, but it focuses on the outcome that we're trying to achieve. Without that, what happens is you end up talking past each other all the time. And one of the things you have to do is come up with definitions of words. So when in a complex world, let me first talk about the word complex. Again, we say that we're trying to describe the future, and we describe the future as that, as complex. We define complex as unknown, unpredictable, and constantly changing. Unknown, unpredictable, and constantly changing. And at first, people may say, well, that's, I'm not sure that's a very, can't you get to any level of detail beyond that? And they'll say, because what they'll want is a prediction. Hey, what are we going to do about Iran? What are we going to do about Syria? What are we going to do about North Korea? What are we going to do about China? What about this? Because they want that level of prediction that, quite honestly, is not generally useful, because generally we are very bad in predicting the specifics like that. What we do is describe what the world is going to look like and what our enemies will do for us. That sometimes is a very difficult thing to get sort of through people's head, because they want predictions. They want accuracy of predictions, because they want to design, in this case, an army for a very specific mission to do a very specific thing in a very specific part of the world. See, now I grew up in that kind of army, because I grew up at sort of the height of the Cold War, and as an armor officer, my first assignment was in Germany, along the inter-German border. And they said, hey, Lieutenant Perkins, this, when this thing goes down, World War III starts, this is the 1,500 meters you're going to. And you're going to take your five tanks, and you're going to dig them in, and this is it. And here's the road march tables to get there. We're going to rehearse it every year with a redeployment of forces to Germany, reforger. Every 90 days, you're going to go up there and recon it, and then you're going to get to know the German unit on your right, the British unit on your left, and you know, we'll constantly run through these rehearsals, etc., because that was dealing with a known enemy in a known part of the world with a known coalition, NATO. We knew who the coalition was, and that coalition didn't change very often. It was hard to get in NATO. It was hard to get out of NATO. It's not like, well, I'm in NATO Monday, I'm leaving on Thursday, I think I'll come back in next Wednesday, etc. It was a pretty set coalition, and it had a pretty set decision-making process. You could have said it was kind of bureaucratic, but I still have my blue NATO handbook, and there was a way to get a decision or an agreement not to make a decision one way or the other. And so that's a known world. What we're saying, the future we're going into, we don't know who we're going to fight. We don't know what the coalition is. We don't know what the ROE, rules of engagement, will be. We don't even know what weapon system the enemy is going to have. When I was growing up, all T-72s were bad. It was, you know, all T-72s were bad. Okay, now we got T-72s in NATO. So you don't even know what weapon system is a bad weapon system. And that's a completely different kind of world. So I tell folks, look, I only need to know, do you want me to design an army to deal with a known problem or an unknown problem? That's all the level of clarity I need, because those are two different kind of armies. If you are building an army to deal with a known problem, with a known enemy, a known part of the world, known coalition, you train people differently. You develop people differently. You buy different kinds of material, and you buy things differently. Very different. If you say, yeah, I want to build an army for the unknown, you train people completely different. You develop it differently. You buy different stuff, and you buy stuff differently. Okay, and I'll get back to that, what the impact has. It, from my point of view, that's the only amount of clarity I need. Do you want an army to deal with a known problem or an unknown problem? Two different kind of armies in a macro sense. I'm looking at the army in general. The next word up there is, and so I tell folks, since I've become the trade-out commander, I get a lot of feedback, and that's good. We're, you know, professional organization, the Army, we want feedback, collaboration. Sometimes that feedback can be in the form of pushback. which is fine. You know, we'll take constructive criticism. Well, the biggest pushback that I have received, and there's a long list of competitors for that honor, since we put this out, what do you think it might be? For putting this word in it. For putting that word in it, okay? Because what they'll say is, hey, Perkins, win, define win. And especially as if I spend time in D.C. or the Beltway and I go to the think tanks, I sometimes call them group think tanks because actually I get a lot of the same questions from the same group, from different groups. And I said, what do you mean by that? And go, well, you know, the Army can't define win. Definitely the trade-off commander can't define win. I said, what do you mean? They go, well, there's a political aspect to win. There's an economic aspect to it. There's a coalition aspect to it. There could be a cultural aspect. There's all kinds of aspects to it. I said, yeah, that's right. I said, actually, that sounds like a strategic concept, win. They said, exactly. I said, that's why we put the word in there. Because we want you to think about this from the strategic point of view. So because you win and lose at the strategic level of war. That's where you win and lose, at the strategic level of war. So when I was growing up, Lieutenant Perkins, known problem set, inter-German border. We had alien battle doctrine. Some of you may have actually read about it in history books. Maybe some of you are old enough to remember. And the problem there in the first chapter said what our concept there was, how to fight outnumbered and win. Fight outnumbered and win. Okay? So it was a problem because you look at the Soviet Union, you look at NATO, known problem, known enemy, known situation for us. Add up their stuff, add up our stuff, we have less. Okay, so we're outnumbered. So how do we fight outnumbered and win? So in the first chapter of that manual, that concept, it said the problem the Army has to figure out is how to fight outnumbered and win. And it also said that air-land battle was the Army's concept for applying combat power at the tactical and operational level of war. Very interesting that in that manual, FM 100-5, it says this is the Army's concept for applying combat power at the tactical and operational level of war in order to fight outnumbered and win. It's very interesting, I thought, when I read it, because it specified the level of war that we were going to design the Army to be optimized at. And so, as I tell folks, since I've been the trade-off commander, I get a lot of feedback. But the feedback I get generally kind of goes like this. Hey, Dave, you know, the future of the Army, since you're the future guy and you're thinking about that, the future of the Army really is all about laser pointers. You just need to buy more laser pointers because, see, if you go like this, it collates all the photons in one area. Leadership is about providing light and direction so you can focus people in the right direction and stuff like that. They're expeditionary because they can fit in your cargo pocket. You know, they're shiny. Everyone loves shiny objects. So the future of the Army is laser pointers. You just need more laser pointers. And then someone else will come, well, no, Dave, really the future of the Army is bottled water. Because life is all about hydration. If you stay hydrated, then you think more clearly, you're healthy, et cetera, like that. And so what I tell folks, a lot of feedback I get really are focused on small answers. Small answers. Buy this. Have one of these. This is how many people are in an infantry squad. You know, you need this many tanks. You need this many brigades. Those are actually small answers, relatively speaking. And so I get a lot of cottage industry small answers. I like this. I want more of those. You should be more like this. You should be less like this, et cetera. You know, these very anecdotal small answers. I tell folks, really, what you need to do and what leaders do, which is all of you when you leave here, you'll be a leader, is ask big questions and don't get consumed by small answers. That's what leaders do, is ask big questions. And so when I started looking at this and looking at previous concepts we had, fight outnumbered and win, and that specifically said, the Army operating concept for the tactical operational level of war, and it caught me by surprise because I said, actually, I had never really thought about opening a manual, and that manual specifically said what echelon of war it was for. You know, I've never remember opening a manual and saying, in case of tactical level of war, do not use this manual, use the next version or something. But actually, this one said, the tactical operational level of war, So actually, I went and spoke with some of the original authors. And I said, well, you know, why did you put that in there? In fact, you know, you might want to rethink it again, because we know there's three echelons of war, and you left one out. You said specifically tactical operational. They said, hey, Perkins, you have to understand a couple of things. We started writing that concept in 1974. So where was the United States Army in 1974? Coming out of Vietnam. And they said, you know what? We had a lot of challenges in the Army back then. We had consumed our non-commissioned officer corps. We did not have a culture of training. We didn't have a modernization plan. We had drug problems. We had race problems. We had a lot of challenges in the Army. And so at the senior Army leader level, we had discussions about this. And we knew there are three levels of war, tactical, operational, and strategic. But we said, if we can just focus the tactical operational level now and kind of get our house together, that will be enough to keep us busy for a couple of weeks. So we're going to eat this elephant a chunk at a time. So they specify in the concept, this is for the tactical operational level of war. And so I go back and tell folks, so actually it's very powerful. Because what I say leaders do, they ask big questions. They don't focus on small answers. And back then, when they started writing that, which really was the Bible I grew up in the Army, the first question those authors, the Army leadership, addressed is, what echelon of war are we going to design the United States Army for? That's a pretty significant question, isn't it? Wouldn't you say that's an adequately big question? What level of war are you going to design the United States Army for? Because if you don't answer that question, do you know what happens to you? You get consumed by small answers. And then when you get all these small answers, you can't compare them to the initial problem that you're dealing with. So that's why in this one, we say win in a complex world. Complex being defined as unknown, unpredictable, and constantly changing. And win denoting the strategic level of war. Okay? So we've started to ask those big questions. What environment are we going to operate in? A known environment or unknown? We said unknown. What level of war do you want to design the United States Army for? We're saying tactical, operational, and strategic level of war. Now, one of the things I always tell folks is never lose clarity in the search for accuracy. Never lose clarity in the search for accuracy. I'm not advocating being inaccurate. What I'm saying is too much, at least in the Army, we can get consumed with such level of accuracy that we have lost all clarity about what we're trying to do. So we're in my office one day and we're working on the operating concept and we hadn't named it or anything. And I said, folks, we have to define the problem here. Let's define the problem. Before we come up with a solution, define the problem. I looked at Airland Battle and they said, fight outnumbered and win. Pretty clearly defined problem, fight outnumbered and win. And therefore they said, we're gonna have to come up with a doctrine that we use our Air Force to fly deep, commit, you know, attack uncommitted echelons. We'll build an M1 tank that can maneuver through the depth of the enemy formation. We'll build an attack helicopter that can engage and track 16 vehicles once. Everything we built was designed to fight outnumbered and win because we had defined the problem, fight outnumbered and win. So I said, that's pretty clear. So I said, come back to the problem with me. So all the smart folks in TRADOC went off and they come back with this four-page Trudeau-like document. And I tell folks, Trudeau-like is not always a term of endearment. And it's four pages that were very, very accurate. Okay, non-nation state actors with nation state capability, weapons of mass destruction, human trafficking, transnational this, transnational that. Apparently nowadays, if you put the word transnational in front of something, it's bad. So on and on and on. It was four pages of very accurate description of problems that the Army and the United States could get involved with. But I looked at it, I said, but this is not very clear. No one's going to read four pages, let alone remember it. I need clarity. All right, sir, we got it. Boom, they go off, come back a couple days later. So we're down to two pages, you know. I go on and on and on. And I said, okay, stop work. We're not getting there. So another thing is when you're a leader of a large, complex organization, which if you're in a military by, or you run a war college or whatever, by design, is a large, complex organization, you have to come up with forcing functions. Okay, if you have 1,000 things you want to do when you first wake up in the morning, you run around in the whack-a-mole mode doing them all yourself, at the end of the day, it'll be 999 that you haven't got done. So you've got to come up with a forcing function. You say, hey, here are two or three things, and do these. And if you do those, I know that it's going to require you to do another 100 to get them done, but I'm focusing on these three because I know it's a forcing function. To do this, you're going to have to do 20 other things. So I said, okay, two things. I got to walk the walk here. First of all, never lose clarity in the search for accuracy. And two, come up with forcing functions. So we're going from 4 pages of accuracy to 2 pages. I'm like, cease work. This is not very clear. So give me the old concept, 100-5, fight out, number it, and win. I said, is that very clear? Oh, sir, that's clear. And I said, see how clear it was? It defined the problem. We're outnumbered. We're going to fight out, number it, and win. We're going to partner with the Air Force, joint combined arms, on and on and on. It, you know, helped us define what kind of tank we want, what kind of helicopter. And so I said, so that's the example of clarity. So forcing function, fight out, number it, and win, fight out, number it, win. I said, 6 syllables. You have 6 syllables to describe the problem that the United States Army is going to solve for the next 60 years. 6 syllables. They're like, sir, come on. You're a 4-star general. Can't you get better guidance than that? How about 7? No, 6. Win in a complex world. Okay? So I said, we're going to get this thing down to 6 syllables. Win in a complex world. And is going to define the problem that we're going to design the most powerful land force the world has ever known for the next 60 years. So if you have 6 syllables to define the problem the most powerful land force the world has ever known is going to be designed around, you've got to squeeze every ounce of blood out of those 6 syllables, right? You've got to get everything you can out of each syllable. So complex, I've already defined as unknown, unpredictable, and constantly changing. I said it's not only unknown, it's probably unknowable. It's kind of like the Heisenberg principle. The fact of measuring something in and of itself changes. That's sort of like the future. If you know something about the future, what are you probably going to do about it? You're probably going to do something about it, which means what? It's probably not going to happen. So what's probably going to happen? Something we don't know too much about. Did we ever fight the Soviets in the Central Plains of Europe? No. Why? Well, for one reason, we knew a lot about them. We prepared for them, et cetera, like that. So what happened? Things we didn't know too much about. Al-Qaeda, Taliban, World Trade Center, IEDs. Things we didn't know much about. Because again, if you know something about it with regards to the future, there's probably a good chance that actually is not going to happen. So probably what is going to happen is something you haven't thought about yet. So how do you develop a force to do that? So that's complex. Win means we're going to focus the tactical, operational, and strategic level of war. So a lot of blood out of that, but got to get more. Got to get 60 years of Army out of this. So now the order of the words is important. So a previous concept was fight, outnumber it, and win. Fight, outnumber it, and win. So what am I telling you to focus on primarily? Fight, right? In other words, the first thing I want you to think about is how to fight, outnumber it, and win. So the first thing that comes to mind is, how do I fight? Okay, if the order of the words is so important, what am I telling you here? The first thing you need to think about is how to win. That's different than initially thinking about how to fight. Now, we're not walking away from fighting, okay? Because here's the other part. Not only is the order of the words, but the sequence is important. Fight, outnumbered, and win. What's the implied relationship there? In order to win, you must fight, right? Fight, outnumbered, and win. To win, you must fight. Here, what am I saying? Just win. You may not have to fight. But, safety tip, okay? And it's not even a 4-day weekend for you Army guys. You're going to get your safety brief. You're going to be careful when you say, oh, so you think you can fight without winning? Got to be very careful, especially if you spend some time in Washington, D.C. like I do, and you go across a river that's there, and there's a big hill with a big building on it, and you go up there and talk to folks, and they say, hey, I heard the Army's thinking about building an Army that can win without fighting. I heard the training commander say, an Army that can win without fighting. I think I'm interested in that Army. That actually sounds like a pretty cheap Army. I mean, really. I mean, one that doesn't have to fight, one that can win without fighting. That's probably a cheap Army, probably mainly like staffs and bands and things, right? I said, okay, be very careful about this. I say to you, if you want an Army or a joint force, if you want to join, they can win without fighting. First of all, that means the only way you can even attempt to have a force that can win without fighting, if everybody knows your current adversaries or your potential adversaries absolutely know, without a doubt, that if it comes down to a fight, you will kick their ass. Unquestioned. If that is the case, then you might have a chance to win without fighting. Okay? Because you have such a level of deterrence capability that it seems almost suicidal to pick a fight. But if there is doubt in people's minds with regards to your capability to win the fight, somebody might pick a fight. So if somebody says, yeah, I'd like to have the capability to win without fighting, generally what I say is break open the checkbook. Okay, we're going to start building capability here as we speak. Now, there's a lot more to it because that's at the strategic level, which involves the economic, the political coalition, all that kind of stuff. But what we really would like to do is win without fighting. So even though it's only six syllables, there's a lot of implied tasks here. There, we're looking from an army as part of the joint world that we want to win in a complex world. We want to build an army as part of the joint force that can win at the tactical, operational, and strategic level of war in an environment that is constantly unknown and constantly changing, and that if possible, we have enough deterrence capability that we never have to fight and always win. Other than that, we're really not asking for too much, okay? So we're saying that's the kind of army we want to build. And actually, that's sort of enough clarity. That's enough clarity for right now. Now, we got to start writing their forced order capabilities. Well, if you want this army as part of the joint force, they're going to have the ability to win at the strategic level with or without fighting. And again, remember, the primary way you can even do it without fighting is that you are par excellence when it comes to fighting. That's a given. We're saying there's a number of things that you, capabilities that you have to have. And this is kind of where we divert a little bit from the previous way of doing things as well, is that we're focusing on capabilities versus things. And I'll come back to that. We had a discussion of it at lunch. So these are capabilities, they're not things. One of it is when we talk about at the strategic level, is as we say the army is a foundation of the joint force, not the most important, not always in charge or anything like that, but we're saying we provide the foundational capability of which we then use all the elements of the joint force in the end to compel activity. Because if you're thinking about a strategic resolution to something, you are looking at compelling activity of the enemy. One of the ways you compel activity is you must be able to consolidate your gains. At the tactical and operational level, you can have a series of exchanging firefights, okay, because that's what you do at the tactical operational level of war. You fight, okay? That's why when the previous Army manual said this is focusing at the tactical operational level of war, it's understandable why the first word was fight, because what do you do at the tactical level of war? You fight. We're saying this is a strategic level of war, so what is our first word? Win, because you win and lose at the strategic level of war. The way you win and lose is you take those tactical and operational victories and you consolidate them in a manner which is sustainable. They have to be sustainable consolidation of gains within the interests of the United States. I mean, let's face it, we're not an altruistic force. We exist to further the national security and national policy decisions and goals of our nation and our coalition partners. So one of the ways to win at the strategic level is you must consolidate gains in a sustainable manner, not a temporary manner, a sustainable manner, a manner that is sustainable militarily, a manner that is sustainable politically, a manner that is sustainable throughout the coalition, et cetera, like that. How do you do that? One of the ways is you have to integrate partners. That's one of the ways you get to sustainable outcomes. You have to be able to integrate partners. Now, you notice here, I don't know, that I'm sure the chief of staff has called me in for counseling, but this is a pictorial diagram, because we like pictures of our 40-page manual, and you can see a little Semper Fi activity going on down here. We got the U.S. Navy, UNHCR, Special Operations Forces, space, cyber, maritime, megacities, littorals, et cetera, like that, NGOs. I actually don't have a picture of a tanker or soldier up there. Okay, this is an inherent joint concept, as well as not even joint, but multinational. So when I say integrate partners, it's not only the Navy, Marine Corps, and Air Force. In fact, that's the easy part. If you are the brigade from the 101st Airborne that is going to Western Africa to deal with Ebola, okay, you need to integrate the World Health Organization, Doctors Without Borders, whatever, maybe UNHCR, et cetera, like that. Those are part of your partners. You've got to integrate them in. And That has huge ramifications for the capability of your organization, staffs, the way you train people, develop them, et cetera. If you're the brigade from the 101st Airborne that's in Western Africa dealing with Ebola, and Doctors Without Borders walks in the back of your operations center, you can't say, okay, here's what we're doing. We're coming up with this big plan. What I need is your resident Command General Staff College graduate that knows how to do the U.S. Army military decision-making process. Send that person down here. We're going to crank out some PowerPoint slides. We're going to brief mission analysis, something like that. No, that can't be the way you operate, okay? You've got to have those iron majors on the staff train that, you know what? Doctors Without Borders, yeah, we've been expecting folks like you. Come on in. We understand what you do. Our military decision-making process has a way to work you in, et cetera, like that. Hey, by the way, how do you communicate with each other? Well, we bought these little things here at Radio Shack, and so we're talking back and forth. No problem, because here our communication stuff, I can just dial you in, and we can talk, et cetera, like that. So when you say integrate partners, that's actually a pretty high bar. That means you have to intellectually integrate them. You've got to integrate them from a planning point of view. You've got to integrate them from a logistical communications policy point of view. That has a huge ramification for it. That means you, when you're at the Command General Staff College or the War College, you have to train those people differently. They can't just understand the Army. They have to understand the world. When you buy a communication system, it better have a capability to integrate partners. You can't say, well, the only way you can talk to me is you have to buy my radio and have my security fill, et cetera, like that. What does that pretty much mean? At best, you'll get other Army folks and you won't even get the whole Army sometimes. So that has huge ramifications as a capability to integrate partners. The other thing we have to think about at the strategic level is how do we present multiple dilemmas to the enemy? Because see, that's at the heart of strategy. And this is the wrong place to be discussing strategy. It was my favorite course I was here. But what you have to do is present multiple dilemmas to the enemy, not a single dilemma. Because generally, the tactical and operational level of war, we present single dilemmas to the enemy, which then eventually the enemy figures out how to mitigate it or deal with it, et cetera, like that. And then we go on to another single dilemma. But see, we're not consolidating gains. We're not putting them in a position of relative disadvantage. So what we have to do is present multiple dilemmas to the Army. Hence, the biggest asymmetric advantage U.S. military has over any other potential adversary in the world is how we operate jointly. Now, we're not perfect. We're not perfect. But I'm telling you, having spent my time, like most of you, in all kind of parts of the world, nobody does joint like the U.S. military. And we're getting better and better at the interagency piece. But it's even got taken beyond that. Coalition partners, NGOs, and all that. But we have to present multiple dilemmas to the enemy. And many times, that's kind of where we come up short. Because we haven't thought through how the enemy is going to view us and deal with this. But see, that's what our operating concept does. It describes what the enemy will do with regards to the U.S. It doesn't predict who the enemy is. It describes him. So what we've done is list some capabilities that the enemy is probably going to try to go after based on studying us. Everyone studies the U.S. For one thing, we're very easy to study. You get your hands on just about anything we do, and it's, you know, on YouTube or, you know, CNN or whatever. So let's think of this scenario. Say I'm an ISIS leader up in Mosul, in northern Iraq. You say, you know what? I'm up here doing the ISIS thing, and I bet after I cut off X number of heads, the U.S. is going to come after me. Okay? Now, what does the U.S. do better than anybody else in the world, at least at the tactical operational level of the world? We target people. Okay? We can target people unlike anybody else. Why? Because when we focus the tactical operational level of war, and we're trying to fight, outnumbered, and win, we look at war as a mathematical problem. Fight, outnumbered, and win. Numbers. So we look at it as a math problem. And so what we do is we've come up with very exquisite ways to acquire and service targets. Because that's what you do at the tactical operational level of war. You reduce the numbers to fight, outnumbered, and win. You reduce the numbers. And the way you reduce the numbers is to acquire and service targets. So war becomes a big mathematical exercise when you think about it from the tactical operational level. So our enemies know that. They know that they target, that we can target just about anybody. And so what are they going to do? We kind of say three things. One, they will avoid our strengths. They will avoid our strengths, they will emulate our capabilities, or they will use our strengths against us. So when I say they're going to avoid our strengths, what do we say our strength is? Targeting. So what are they going to do? They're going to avoid being a target because they say that's our strength. So what does that mean? They probably will not coalesce in large armored formations in the middle of the desert anymore. Okay, they will not coalesce in large formations. They will probably maybe take off uniforms. They'll blend into the local population. They'll go subterranean. Do you think these people like living underground? Okay. No, they do that because we're so good at targeting, because they're avoiding our strengths, regardless of who it is. Do you think it's easier to build an atomic facility above the ground or under the ground? Why do they build it under the ground? Because we're so good at targeting. I told you so. They're going to avoid our strengths. Okay? So we always have to think, if I'm building a strength someplace, how easy is it to avoid? So within, or they'll use our strengths against us. Because you know what? They know we like to use what we're good at. Everybody does what you're good at, right? If you're a good baseball player, you don't try out for the soccer team. You try out for the baseball team. So if we become very good at something, we like to use that. And then the enemy knows that, and they have two options. They'll either avoid us, subterranean, blending the population, or they'll use it against us. So back to this ISIS guy in Mosul. He said, I'm cutting off heads here. I'm doing the ISIS thing. I'm gonna play both ends of this off against the United States. One is I will try avoid being a target, so the leadership doesn't go to command and staff meetings and have large open formations, everything like that. They're very dispersed. They blend in the population. They have underground stuff. And so they're like, we're going that line of action. And they said, you know what? I read the U.S.'s manual. I'm going to present the U.S. multiple dilemmas. So one of my dilemmas is I will avoid their strengths. The other dilemma is I'm going to use their strength against them. So I know the U.S. loves to target people. They are the preeminent target people. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to get some suicide bombers here. So I'll get some suicide bombers. Therefore, not a lot invested in PME, healthcare, retirement, everything like that. They're pretty low overhead. I'm going to go on eBay, buy some cheap Toyota pickup trucks, or better yet, I'll steal some pickup trucks that the U.S. gave to the Iraqi forces. And I'm going to put these suicide bombers in pickup trucks. I'm going to start driving around, okay, around Mosul. And then you know what's going to happen? We're watching the news or in our operations center watching Kill TV, and all of a sudden we see an X appear on that pickup truck. And we know what's coming next after that X appears on the pickup truck, right? Kablam! Okay? And so we destroy that pickup truck, and there's high fives in the talk, everything like that, because at the tactical level of war, we won that exchange of firepower. Okay? That white Toyota pickup truck did not do anything to that JDAM. That JDAM was unscathed. So we won that exchange of firepower. But at the strategic level, as I said, strategic level has not only a firepower part to it, but it's got an economic part. So let's talk about the economic exchange equation here. So I have a suicide bomber, a cheap and or stolen white pickup truck, okay, and I've just dropped a smart munition on. So how much money did that smart munition cost me? How many aircraft did we have up in the air servicing that, the refuelers, the KAOC, et cetera, like that? So it's costing us millions of dollars to take out a $400 pickup truck. So what's the economic exchange ratio of that? In fact, they say, you know what? If I'm the U.S.'s enemy, I might keep this up for a while because I'm at a very low cost putting them in an economic disadvantageous position, okay? So their strategic economic exchange ratio is a dilemma for the U.S., and I don't think this is sustainable. Hence, sustainable gains, consolidate gains in a sustainable manner. I was at a briefing with all our cyber folks, and they're talking about this cyber problem, and so-and-so printed with a cyber problem. They go, sir, don't worry, we got a problem. We got an answer to it. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. We're going to do that. I'm like, well, how much is that going to cost? Ah, sir, probably $10, $15 million, but you know, how long is it going to take? It'll take a year or something. I said, well, how long do you think it took the enemy to develop this thing? Well, you know, probably a couple of weeks and a couple thousand dollars. I said, look, we can no longer have million-dollar solutions to $100 problems. If I come up with a $1 million solution to a $100 problem, first of all, I'm in a dilemma, not the enemy, one. Two, it's not sustainable. What I need is a $50 problem to a $100 problem. I need a $50 solution to a $100 problem. And see, that's why you have to think about in the macro level what level of war are you engaging these folks on, and what is a dilemma for them, okay? What is a dilemma for them is something they value, putting something they value at risk. something that they value, not that we would value. If they don't value lives, taking lives is not going to compel activity because you haven't got into the economic exchange ratio that is in your favor. So, and I list a number of sort of other things here. We have to maneuver from multiple locations, but able to have mutually supporting effect. I see some concepts out there that have we have folks at multiple locations, but mutually isolated. Well, the enemy would like that. You've got to have multiple locations, but mutually supportive. So when you start designing aircraft or ground vehicles or something like that, can you move from one domain to another quickly, et cetera? So this goes on and on, but this is kind of a macro sense of how we're thinking about the future differently, Next slide. And one of the issues is, and go to the next slide, is we're focusing on capabilities. And that's actually somewhat of a difficult thing in the Army as we transition, because again, if I go around DC and I have this book, the first people say, okay, where's the list of things you're going to buy? I say, well, there's no things in here. What these are is first order capabilities. In fact, this doesn't talk about force structure. It doesn't have an acquisition plan to it. It doesn't talk about how many divisions are in the Army or anything. It doesn't say anything about money. And like, well, how can you even publish a book like that in Washington, D.C.? If you don't talk about force structure, money, and all that. I said, that's not the purpose of this. The purpose of this is to describe the environment we're going to be in, and then what are the first order capabilities, and then start prioritizing them. And this is where the Army, in some ways, is a little bit different than some other elements of the joint force out there. Not bad, not worse, et cetera, like that. As I say, as we produced the manual, the intent was not to be overly parochial, just adequately parochial. When I say adequately parochial, it's to describe what the Army does by operating primarily in the domain of land as a land power, and how that interfaces with the rest of the other domains in the joint force. So if you take a look, the other areas that we operate in, if you take a look at, say, air and sea, to be able to operate in those areas, by definition, you have to be in a piece of technology, okay? You just do. It's kind of the laws of physics. You can't be at 30,000 feet unless you are in a piece of technology, okay? You can't be 1,000 miles offshore unless you can tread water, unless you are in a piece of technology. So you generally can't be operating in space unless you are in a piece of technology. I mean, that's just a law of physics. So to be in those domains, okay, you have to be in a piece of technology. You have to be surrounded by technology because that's just the way it is, okay? So those domains do tend to focus on technology because you just aren't there unless you're in one. And the domain that we operate in land, most people in the world are there and they're not in anything. They're just there. So technology, while a key enabler to land forces, has a different characteristic to it, because it is not essential to operate in that domain, although it is very advantageous. So what we focus on land is not the technology in and of itself, but technology paired with soldiers as part of a formation, as part of a capability for the joint force. So what we focus on is capabilities, not necessarily technology. Because when I go around, especially to the appropriators and things like that, what they are looking for are a list of things to buy to fight. Things to buy to enable me to fight. What I tell folks is I'm not primarily focusing on a list of things to buy to fight. I am focusing on how the Army builds capability to win. Buying things to fight versus capability to win is a very different focus, okay? Now, there are things involved, but that's not the primary, you know, our plan for the future is not a list of things, it's a list of capabilities, okay? And here are some of the capabilities. So what we are doing is every quarter, this is the first year, this has been out a year, we have these warfighting challenges. We do five a quarter, so, you know, you do the math, there's 20 this year. But a couple of things will pop out. One, as you can see, they all kind of start with verbs. These aren't things. It's a capability. How do I develop situational understanding? Not let me buy an Intel system. Develop understanding is different than buying an Intel box. Okay. Develop agile and adaptive leaders. Conduct entry operations. Okay. That's an inherently a joint construct. So we conduct these every quarter. We do five of these, and we bring in all the Army folks that you saw on that huge Byzantine Empire chart, plus our joint partners, plus state folks and things like that, because some of these have a lot more to do even than just the kinetic part of it. And what we're saying is conduct entry operations. Well, there's probably a Navy part to that. There's a Marine part to that, obviously an Army part to that, Air Force. There's all kinds of bits and pieces go to it. You know, counter WMD. Counter weapons of mass destruction. There's a huge political aspect to it. There is an intel understanding part of it. There are mitigation aspects to it. But is what happens is when we start focusing on capabilities versus things, what it does, at least for us as an Army, is it does start to prioritize eventually what things you need. But what we look at is not the things that the person who owns that category prioritizes, but we look at the things that provide us the biggest capability across the whole Army. I'm sure it doesn't happen in the other services, but every now and then in the Army, we can get a little stovepiped, okay? And if I'm an armor guy, an infantry guy, my priority is I want the best tank. Okay, so it's all about, if I have a problem with a tank, then the trades have to come with the tank. You want a faster engine, then you get a smaller gun tube, or you know, you're always trading with amongst yourselves. Or if you're the Intel guy, you've got your satellite or whatever it is, and you've got this amount of money, and if you want to do this, you take this away, smaller antennas, whatever. We would say in the Army we have the pegs, and they're like, well, you got to solve the problem within your own peg. But the problem is that's not how war is fought. The enemy doesn't just go after one of your things. Well, okay, today we're just going after the Intel warfighting function, and then tomorrow we'll just go after the sustainers. No, the enemy goes after the entire capability of the U.S. So we said we ought to. And that's how you fight war, right? We don't send one thing out by itself. We send out a formation of capabilities. And we're saying that's our asymmetric advantage, that if you have the right mix of capabilities, you can present multiple dilemmas to the enemy, okay? So maybe I don't want the perfect tank, as hard as it is for me to say as a former armor officer. What I want is a tank that is adequately good enough within the formation. And that formation has so many dilemmas it can present to the enemy that at any given point in time, the enemy is at a point of disadvantage. So when the enemy does their risk calculation, they say, you know what? There are so many risks here, I can't mitigate them all at once. I think I might not pick a fight. Now you've deterred your enemy because not only are your capabilities so great, but they're so broad and there are so many dilemmas, the enemy can't deal with them all simultaneously. Okay? And so what we have is a list of capabilities, of which then there are things that are cross-cutting amongst all of them. So we did one last quarter, and we had developed situational understanding, counter weapons, mass destruction. So I had the 2nd Infantry Division commander from Korea was on, you know, like 3 in the morning over there. Conduct entry operations and developed agile and adaptive leaders. So you see, leader development is one of our top capabilities that we need. And so you would think, well, gosh, those are completely different things. Leader development, weapons of mass destruction, entry operations. But what we kind of find out when we looked at the capability, you started to come up with these common things that would service all of them. So the 2nd Infantry Division in Korea goes, you know what? I've got a huge underground network because the enemy's going to avoid my strengths, which is targeting. So they put everything underground. So he said, in Korea, I have a big problem, a lot of subterranean operations. And there's probably all kinds of WMD and all that. And so if we were to go in there and deal with it, I'd have to put a WMD expert down every tunnel and stuff like that. We don't have that capacity in the Army. I can't build a huge force structure so that every tunnel has their own WMD expert or something like that. And so the 82nd Airborne Division commander, he was down at Tradeoff headquarters doing entry operations, goes, so you know what, I got to go over there quick. I got to go over there fast. I need a small footprint. I can't take, you know, I can't zero out the C-17 fleet of the United States Air Force. I got to get over there quickly. I got to get operational, like something like that. General Brown, who owns Agile Adaptive Leaders, he says, you know what? I've got to have training that's complex. I've got to put together multiple training centers. I can't bring everybody to the Army together. So each one is saying, you know what I need is I need reach back. Okay, so the 2nd Infantry Division Commander said, you know what? If I could have a camera on every infantryman that I put down in a tunnel that then can see weapons of mass destruction, is plugged into Fort Lindenwood, where all our chemical experts are in the Army, I can just have one center of chemical experts, and I can feed that information in. Then the 82nd Airborne Division Commander said, you know what? If I could take a small command and control element forward and have all my intelligence asset analysis done in the back and all my logistical planning, so if I had reach back to go back there. And then General Brown goes, you know what? If I could connect all our training facilities in the Army together, network, so I can have battalions, brigades, divisions, corps, complexity, so if I could reach everything like that. So you know what one of the priorities is in the Army now? We have to develop a network and a reach back capability that we can link together all of our, we call it home station as a docking station. We take all of our home station capability at Fort Bragg, at Fort Carson, and Fort Hood, and we instrument it so I can plug in WMD folks, I can conduct training exercises, I can deploy very small footprints and leave the what we call our main command post back there. And what does that mean? I got to get with Lieutenant General Halverson, who's our installation management command. He's the guy that sort of runs all our post camps and stations. So I got to get with him. I got to get with the Army G6 CIO and say, this is the priority for fiber optic, et cetera, et cetera, like that. So now, out of these capabilities are things, but it's not even anything listed there. Again, it's an enabling capability to get after multiple capabilities. The problem is the Army isn't designed to do that. Our Army is designed from an acquisition role and resourcing, all that is very stovepipe. And so now what we have to do is move resources from one thing, one stovepipe of things, to another stovepipe of things, so I can build capability, so I can win at the strategic level in a world that's unpredictable. So see why it's important to go through this. As a mentor of mine says, the intellectual leads the physical. The intellectual leads the physical. If you haven't thought through the problem, if you haven't answered, if you haven't asked the big questions, before you start focusing on small answers, you're going to get to a problem. Because if you haven't done the intellectual homework first, you're going to come up to a solution that is actually not your problem. Okay? So that's what our Army operating concept does is try to ask the big question and define the problem from a strategic point of view. Next slide. So in the Army, we say we come up with a dot mil PF solution to this, dot mil PF solution to a capability. The first D is for doctrine, organization, training, leader, development, material, et cetera, like that. So this is our leadership doctrine. And again, the Army is a doctrine-driven organization. And this is ADP60, our mission command, which is our command philosophy and our warfighting function. When I first came into TRADOC, we had large field manuals. And I was talking to the person in charge of doctrine, the Army. I said, well, how much doctrine are they? He goes, sir, we have like 500 field manuals, and they're from 100 to 300 pages. I'm like, whoa, I probably haven't read them all. That's where doctrine gets a bad name, very confining, et cetera. So, well, don't worry, sir, you know, we're going to update it all, et cetera, like that. Well, we have, and we've got it down. See, this is the advantage of having a former armor officer as your TRADOC commander, somebody that does not have command of a lot of words. You get short doctrine. So now we're down to 15 books. Okay, the guidance was each one had to be 10 pages. This one is 12, because everything's possible in the Army with a waiver. But so there's only 15 books. And the good thing about it, again, if in case you're pressed for time, the first page is almost a picture. It's a logic diagram. So this is the logic diagram out of this book, ADP60. And what it is our doctrinal approach to how are you going to win in a complex world. Because what I say, intellectual leads physical. So we kind of have, hey, we've got to win at the tactical, operational, strategic level of war. I have to preside multiple dilemmas. I always have to be in a position of relative advantage. I got to sustain gains, and I have to have gains sustained in a, you know, or a sustainable manner, et cetera, like that. So we started to write this out. Now, so the first thing is, the good thing about these logic maps, so this is the book right here, Mission Command Philosophy. It's a command philosophy and warfighting function. And Unified Land Operations is our warfighting capstone document, ADP 30. And what we say, what the Army is for, what is the Army for, is to seize, retain, and exploit the initiative. Seize, retain, exploit the initiative. You notice it doesn't say seize the high ground, retain the bridge crossing or anything like that. Seize, retain, and exploit the initiative to get to a position of relative advantage. Okay? Now, there's a couple of things in that. Because a lot of people say, well, why wouldn't you say absolute advantage? And I say, well, because I told you, complex is defined as unknown, unknowable, and constantly changing. So everything's relative. And so you always have to be at a position of relative advantage. And so I'll give a sort of geographically based example. If I'm on a piece of high ground here and the enemy's down here, you say, hey, I'm in a position of advantage. And that's why we say seize, retain, and exploit the initiative. Not merely seize and retain, inadequate to retain the initiative. Because if you're saying, I'm on this piece of high ground here, bad guys down here, I'm going to retain this. I'm going to dig in, overhead cover, more bottled water, laser pointers, everything I need, I'm digging in. I'm going to retain this position of advantage. See, that works in a known world. The world that I grew up in, if you retain the full of the gap, you were going to be probably okay. Okay? Because we knew the Germans and the Brits and all those folks weren't going to change sides. So you, in a known world, retaining the initiative is probably okay. In an unknown world, it's not okay. Because what you know will change constantly. So if you're in this piece of high ground here and the enemy's down here, but if overnight the enemy signs a coalition treaty with the folks up here and the sun comes up, where are you now? You're at a position of disadvantage. Was it because anything that you did? No. It's because the world changed and you didn't keep up with it. So what we're saying in this world that is unknown, unknowable, and constantly changing, you have to seize, retain, and exploit the initiative. If you are not always exploiting the initiative to constantly get to a better position of relative advantage, it's just a matter of time until your current position becomes a position of disadvantage, even if you don't change. Because what we're saying is the world is going to change. The world is changing so quickly that it does not take long till the enemy avoids your strengths. And so you cannot be comfortable with only one dilemma to present the enemy. So that's why we say, well, then you've got to have a command philosophy that does that. You have to be able to seize, retain, and exploit the initiative. You've always got to be one step ahead. You've always got to be thinking through this. Because as I tell folks, war is a series of temporary conditions. War is just a series of temporary conditions. It really, everyone, I want an exit strategy or how do we finish war? You really never finish it. It just moves to another level, to another phase of it, really. I mean, so, you know, we won the Cold War. We're still dealing with Russia. We're still dealing with Putin. It's just another phase. It has another characteristic, not another nature, the continuity of the nature war, but a different characteristic. Why? Were we always thinking, I have to keep exploiting this, I got to exploit this, get to another position advantage, or did we allow ourselves to get to a position of disadvantage because we thought it was over, because we thought the competition of power was over, because we forgot about the continuities of the nature of war, which is constant struggle of power. Okay, so how do you do that? Part of it is how do you train and develop leaders? So all of our doctrine, and it's good to say, since I'm in a joint facility like this, it's completely nested with joint doctrine, except for one. The sixth warfighting function in joint doctrine is command and control. The sixth warfighting function in Army doctrine is mission command. Now, two things. People come to me and say, Dave, why did you change command? Why did you do away with command and control? It's the same thing as mission command. What'd you need, just OER support form bullet so you can get MSM or something? I said, well, I could use a bullet, but it's actually two things. One, we did not do away with command and control. It's in the book, underlined in bold, okay? So it's in the mission command book, it's underlined in bold. So for any of you Army folks out there, they say, hey, you did away with command and control. It says, no, I saw the trade-out commander's book. It's in there and it's underlined in bold. It's just that it's not a warfighting function. It is subordinate to the warfighting function. Because in a known world, command and control was defined as command, I issue a command, control, I ensure compliance. Command, I tell you what to do. Control, I ensure compliance with what I told you what to do. Command and control. What we're saying in Army doctrine, mission command is not focusing on control to assure compliance, but it's balancing command and control, to empower the initiative. You don't control initiative, you empower initiative. It doesn't mean you are absent command and control. It's just the function of command and control, the purpose, is no longer to ensure compliance, but rather the empowerment of exploitation of the initiative. It's dramatically different versus controlling compliance. Because see, in a known world, with a known enemy, and a known problem set, you focus on compliance. Okay? In an unknown world, with an unknown enemy, with an unknown problem set, you focus on exploiting the initiative to always be in a position of relative advantage. Constantly changing, three-dimensional. Economic advantage, political advantage, et cetera, like that. You train people very differently. You train people very differently. Okay? So it's not just a nuanced discussion of definitions. Because see, when this Lieutenant Perkins joined the Army, a known problem set the Soviet Union, Central Plains, Europe, they said, you're going to take your five M60 non-rise, non-passive tanks, and you're going to dig them in. This is your 1,500 meters. This is it. I have 1,500 meters. Here's your road march tables. And every 90 days, you're going to go up there in your Jeep and recon where your tanks are going. And at the end of, and if the Germans put up a high power tension line, figure out how you're going to take it down so you can fire the TOW missiles. If they put a bridge, can they handle a tank? Find out where your chambered shape charges are going to go. Again, get to know the Germans on your right, the Brits on the left. We want you to know better something that you already know a lot about. Just know it more and more and more and recon it in a battle book. So when I was kind of commander, I had a battle book in my safe. You pull it out, maps, overlay, grease pencil. And when the big one came, the intent was execute the script. Just go through this, go here. Don't be late to the bridge crossing because you'll hold up 5th Corps. If you're early, you'll be in front of 7th Corps. Execute everything as planned. Get there, Perkins, 1,500 meters, dig in, and just wait for it to happen. That's how you train leaders to deal with the known world, is you rehearse the similar scenario over and over and over again. You rehearse it and you recon it because you're expecting them basically to execute the script. In an unknown world, that doesn't work. And so Lieutenant Perkins nowadays, of which there is a Lieutenant Perkins, we say, you know, I can't give you 1,500 meters of where you're going. I have no idea who the enemy is. I have no idea who the ROE is. I don't know who's to your right. I don't know who's to your left. The only thing I do know is you will not recon it every 90 days. As a matter of fact, the first time you will probably ever see that place is when you are there showing up for the fight. And then you will have an ROE, which will probably change constantly. You will have a coalition, which will probably change constantly. You will have caveats, which probably change constantly. And whatever is a position of advantage today could very well be a position of disadvantage tomorrow. So don't focus on holding the full of the gap, only if that's advantageous. So now how do you develop that Lieutenant Perkins? You develop that Lieutenant Perkins very different than you develop this Lieutenant Perkins. Because what did we do as an Army with this Lieutenant Perkins? We commanded him where to go, and we controlled his movement there. Don't be early, don't be late, be on time. And this is exactly where you're going. Are there any questions, Perkins? And just to make sure, you're going to prove this every 90 days that you've got it down for me. See, that doesn't work in today's world. See, that's why all I need to know is, do you want me to build an army to deal with a known problem or an unknown problem? Because when you give me Lieutenant Perkins, he's either going to be trained this way or I'm going to train him this way. I'm going to buy this material or I'm going to buy that material. I'm going to buy this material this way and that material this way. Very, very different. And how do you do this? Right here. And I say, so if you're a commander or a leader, you only have to do three things. So I talk at the pre-command course every month. So I say, look, you only have to do three things as a brigade commander. It's not like when I was a brigade commander when you really had to do a lot and know what you're doing. Very simple, only three things. And I put them in a box and put a period in front of each one so I don't want to hear complaining about how difficult and the burden of responsibility of command is. Only have to do three things. The first one is drive the operations process as compared to attend it. I've worked for some commanders that attended the process. I'm not sure whether they drove the process. Drive the process through, understand, visualize, describe, direct, lead, and assess. What we're saying is you need to understand the environment, understand the players, understand the caveats. It doesn't mean, a lot of people think mission command means absence of restrictions. Oh, it only works in war if you can do whatever you want. No, it doesn't. It just means you have to understand those restrictions. You have to understand the caveats. Understand that the coalition could change every day. Understand your ROE. You need to understand, do you understand the world, the Doctors Without Borders folks? Do you understand their culture? Do you understand sort of their reason for being here, their purpose? Do you understand that? Then once you completely understand the environment you're in, all the players, all their caveats, what everybody's end state is, which may not be the same as yours, understand why the coalition partner's here. Once you understand that, then visualize. Visualize how you're going to take all of your elements of combat power and array them in time and space to accomplish your mission. Then once you, based on a common understanding, visualize the solution, describe it to people, subordinates, peers, and superiors alike, coalition partners, describe it to them in a way that results in the same visualization to them. You notice it's not understand, visualize, tell. In the Army, we can kind of get into the tell mode. Hey, you're going to do this, do this, do this. Do you think if I'm talking to folks in a PRT that work for the State Department, do you think I'm going to describe what I'm doing differently than when I'm talking to 3rd Platoon? Very differently. Their frame of reference is completely different. Their end states differently. So it's not understand, visualize, tell. It's understand, visualize, describe. You have not described it until they have the right visualization, not you, until they have the right visualization, leading to a common understanding. Then direct, lead, and assess. But you don't start directing until you have this common visualization based on a common understanding. Command and control is tell. Command, I tell you to do this. Control, I ensure compliance. That's why command and control is inadequate, we think, for the future. Because you can't just tell people to do stuff and control them. You have to describe your visualization and then empower the exploitation of the initiative. That's the only way you can always be in a position of relative advantage compared to a world that's constantly changing. Then directly assess. But the assess part is different. Because in the world I grew up with, command and control, command, I tell you what to do, control, ensure compliance, and then when I assess you, I assess compliance with the command. I assess compliance with the command. So I was a division commander in Iraq, and I go down to my operations center, and plasma screens everywhere, tiered seating, and there's always an assessment center, of course. We love to assess everything, measure everything. And you know, you'd have all the, you know, green, amber, red, God forgive you if anything's black on these stoplight charts. And, you know, assessment, how we go, well, sir, here's the good news. We're supposed to be at objective A by Friday, but the good news is we're going to be there by Thursday. So our assessment of the compliance with the plan is green. We're ahead of schedule. We're supposed to be objective A by Friday, and we're going to be there by Thursday. But under mission command, what I really need is an assessment of the adequacy of the understanding of the problem, not an assessment of the compliance with the plan. What I really needed that day was my S2 or operations officer to get up and say, sir, the bad news is, yeah, we will be at objective A by Thursday instead of Friday. The problem is the enemy moved from A to B on Tuesday. So what we really are, we're ahead of schedule of an irrelevant plan, okay? So we need to spend more time assessing our adequacy of our understanding of the problem than assessing compliance with the plan. So I've commanded at multiple levels before, and I guess I always left, but it would have been the most important part of the brief. When the guy was throwing up the chart, I should have had the plans officer saying, so we're going to do this, we're going to do this, and here are the indications that this plan is a piece of crap. Here they are right here. When you start seeing these things, this plan is worthless, and you need to direct me to rip it up and start again. I apparently always left before that slide was brief, but it really would be the most important slide for them to tell me, because it's their assessment of our understanding of the problem. And guess what? In a known world, you really are focusing on assessment with your ability to control compliance with what's going on, because in a known world, the Soviets are always the enemy, okay? They're always trying to get to the full of the gap. But in an unknown world, all kinds of stuff's going on, political discussions, economic issues, something like that. And what may be a position of advantage today may not be a position of advantage tomorrow. So developing leaders and training staffs and creating organizations that bring in understanding versus measures of compliance, that's a very different kind of army. That's very, very different. So when people say, well, Perkins, what, you've given up trying to predict the future? I mean, when you were growing up, we told you it was the Soviet Union, Central Plains of Europe. What, are you giving up trying to predict the future? And I go, yes, I have. Well, what, are you just stupid and lazy? Well, we could argue that point. But the issue is that that's not the future of the world. That is an inadequate kind of army, I think, for the kind of world we're going to deal with in the future. We have to have an army as part of a joint force. They can always be in a position of relative advantage, the tactical, operational, and strategic level of war. We're constantly assessing our understanding of the problem, constantly integrating partners, and coming up with a plan of which we can consolidate our gains in a way that is sustainable to us. And that means we're changing many things that we're doing in the Army. Our acquisition processes, how we train people, how we develop people, what we teach at the War College, what we teach at basic training. Well, we teach at basic training. When they come off that bus and meet their friend, the drill sergeant with the, you know, Smokey the Bear hat, we've changed a lot of things in basic training, trying to build in critical thinking, understanding the bigger picture, et cetera, like that. Can't wait till you get to War College and say, well, I'm going to take the critical thinking elective. Too late now. Okay. What I'd like to do now is pause here and open up for questions, recommendations, big questions, small answers, whatever. So just kind of, you know, trade arc, Army operating concept, the Army in one little, you know, hour brief or whatever like that. So questions, it's got to be questions. Somebody. Yes, back there.
Sir, Lieutenant Commander Michael Scaris, U.S. Navy. Thank you for coming and talking to us today. 2013, I graduated from CGSC, and while I was there, as a part of the curriculum after next.
Yeah.
Ever, I was wondering what you thought of it, and has anything been implemented?
Yeah, actually, great effort there. A couple of things that actually have come out of it, and at CGSC in general, and then specifically from that, you know, the constant, I don't know if you all get it here, the constant criticism we got, I don't know if you agree with this, is excess amount of contact hours. So folks can't have don't have time to think, et cetera, like that. So we are looking at reducing contact hours to get to that aspect of it. One of the challenges we have at CGSC, I'd be very interested in how you all do it here at your, what do you call it, intermediate leader course or whatever your CGSC equivalent, is as we bring folks in across the Army, and this is one of the challenges we have as we sort of run our Army processes, you end up with a non-homogeneous group of people. So if you get 1,000 people to come up to CGSC, they're non-homogeneous, both of all. I mean, we have, you know, doctors and lawyers and infantrymen and logisticians and everything there. So you don't have a homogeneous background of folks. So their understanding of tactical operational issues is not common. So you've got to do some training to get to this, because they're like, is this a training institution or an education institution? I say yes. So because you've got to get a base level of training so that people can talk similarly. And then you start educating people on how to think critically, how to analyze and all that. So it's a balance constantly between them, which is I think is the dynamic that we have at Command and General Staff College. But one of the big things is, or a couple of things, one, we are reducing contact hours. The other thing we're doing across the Army, hey guys, do you have the Army University slide? Actually, this would be great while we're here. Another partner I can get. So we took a look across Training and Doctrine Command in the Army and said, we have a lot of capability out there, but it's not always focused and it's not always synchronized. So across TRADOC, we have over 100 schools and centers, et cetera, like that. We had 48 different libraries, all had their own contract and knowledge management systems, et cetera, like that. So we built a contract called Army University, where what we've done is take all the training and education capability, most of it's in TRADOC, and partnered with the Army War College. Yeah. So now we have the Army University. And so we have all of the schools and centers and educational capability, whether it's DLI, the Defense Language Institute, whether it's the Aviation Center of Excellence, et cetera, like that, Command General Staff College, Sergeant Major's Academy, U.S. Army War College, West Point, we have out there working together with us. And we're saying what we're going to do is try to leverage all this capability, connect command with our 300 schools and universities, to say, hey, can we do a better job, number one, of producing a better product, but number two, in developing our instructors, and then leveraging all the capacity we have, and then three, partnering with outside organizations. So the way this goes is I'm sort of the chancellor of the Army University system here, and then the chief and the secretary up here, sort of the board of regents or whatever. And what we have found by putting all of these under one, and we try not to do without creating excessive overhead, but saying, you know what? If we can coordinate what we do internally to the Army so that you move from one level of PME to the next more seamlessly, number one. And then two, we're finding it's much easier for us to partner with outside organizations. Because if I say, hey, go to Princeton or Berkeley or even a university system in Texas or something, they say, I want you to partner with a center of excellence. They're like, what's a center of excellence? What's that? It doesn't resonate with them. If I say, hey, I want you to partner or have an exchange professor with Army University, they're like, well, I know a university system. I know how that works. So what we found now is university systems throughout the country are very interested in partnering with us, like University System of Texas, University of California, or Virginia, where one thing, we have a lot of Army bases in those states, but the other thing is they're saying, and we want to exchange faculty, because what we're finding is to get be able to integrate partners in critical thinking, I need people that don't think just like the Army thinks. And so if I can get professors from other universities, industry is partnering with us because they're like, hey, some of the R&D you do, but specifically with leader development and all that, we would like that in our, and so a lot of corporations have their own education processes. Boeing has a leader development campus I've been to and all that. They said, we would like to partner with you. Could you send some of your folks to our place and send some folks to yours? So we think this is a great construct for us to partner with other educational facilities, with other businesses and other people that are sort of in the intellectual leads, the physical realm, so that we get different ways of seeing the problem. We can develop our ability to be critical thinkers and put our students, which is why it's great to see so many soldiers out here, in an environment where people don't think like them and look at problems differently. So those are a couple of the big things that we've attempted to get after with that, but it is a work in progress, and it's kind of like those things. We always have to exploit the initiative and always be in a position of relative advantage. So there's not an end state, but those are the couple of the big things we're tracking. So I'd love to partner with the Navy War College, my alma mater here, and get folks in. I know we have instructors here. Other questions? Yes.
Good afternoon, sir. Commander Mike Ray, thank you for your time this afternoon. The current issue of The Economist includes a pretty sobering assessment of military recruiting focused pretty heavily on the Army.
Yeah.
And talking about the sort of portion of the population that is simply not recruitable. I wonder how you reconcile that with what appears to be an increasing demand of cognitive capability as evidenced by things like mission command, developing agile and adaptive leaders and so forth.
Yeah, that's a great question. In fact, I was just exchanging emails this morning with the Chief Staff of the Army about recruiting. So I really had not been involved with the recruiting command till I got here, so this is a broadening experience for me. And it's really fascinating. In fact, when your folks are just going to command one of our brigades, recruiting command. And a couple things jump out, and this is about contextualizing the world. One of the things when I talk about the United States Army, when I start to go around the world and talk to other folks, is the first thing I have to contextualize is scale. The scale that we do things at, because a lot of people come to me with good ideas, small answers. Dave, do this, do that, et cetera. So I was at a Fortune 50 company recently and talking about how they do leader development and things. They say, you know, the CEO is really involved in it. In fact, he tries to interview everybody we hire. Interview, personally talk to them, make sure we get a round peg and a round hole, et cetera, like that, and how we talk about it. I go, that's very interesting. That's commitment, leader development. Do you know how many people the United States Army recruits every year, active duty, guard, and reserve? 120,000 people. We recruit 10,000 people a month into the Army. So I said, wow, if the Chief of Staff of the Army is going to interview everybody we hire, he better get on it. And if he takes a month off, that's 20,000 next year. So with regards to that, if somebody says, hey, this is a good idea, if I can't do it 10,000 times a month, then it's an idea. So, but to your point there, one of the challenges we have, really, when I back up, because I'm always interested in backing up an IV line and really looking at the totality of the problem, we kind of have an industrial age process for recruiting, some of it's by law, but also for how we look at the strength in the Army and how many people recruit, et cetera, like that, because we have an attrition-based model. And so now this is part of the benefit of the Chief being able to put the tag on one thing. I say, well, sir, I'm recruiting great folks. It's just that basic training is all screwed up and they're not doing well there. Or when they get there, it's like, well, hey, Perkins, fix it. So I own basic training. So we have an attrition rate of about 12 to 14% through basic training. And so that accounts for, so in other words, we have to recruit over that amount, because you have to assume I'm going to lose 12-15%, so when I have to deliver the force this amount. And then by the end of the first term, again, we can, in other words, completing their first term of enlistment, is like over 33% attrition. So that's a lot of attrition. Okay, that in other words, we built that into all our algorithms for our personnel people. Like, we're going to attrit this many people out that don't complete their first term of enlistment. So you've got to recruit this many people so that I get this many people through basic training so I get this many people that finish their first term of enlistment. Well, when you work it all the way back, we have this called contact to contract ratio. So my recruiters can tell you wherever they are in the country, on average, how many people they have to contact, you know, go out to high schools or sit down with mom and dad or whatever, to contact, what's the ratio between how many people they contact to how many people sign a contract in the Army. So what happens is you contact X amount of people, then we contract them, they convince them that this is the best thing to do with their life, and then some of them don't pass the physical beyond that, and then they, you know, attrit out of basic training and everything like that. So based on those attrition models I just gave you, for the scale of this, we recruit about 120,000 every year in the Army, about 70,000 those are active force, etc. like that. We want X amount to be there at the end of the first term. Do you know how many people every year I have to contact to contract that many? 17 million. So last year I had to contact 17 million people to get my 60,000 people to on and on and on like that. Well, that is a very labor-intensive process. And so what we are looking at, and so the problem is it's based on this attrition model. So understand the problem, visualize how you're going to solve it. So mission command is not just combat, it's everything we do. And we said, you know, what if I could reduce attrition, kind of getting to your point, what if I reduced attrition through this process so that I didn't have to recruit as many people and then therefore don't have to contact as many, so I can reduce the size of recruiting command. Everybody that washes out of basic training costs me about $82,000, okay? So that's an $82,000 cost that I've just incurred there. So what if I can reduce attrition? So then I take a look at what are the things, now it's about understand the problem, define the problem before you come up with a solution. So we start taking a look at what are the things that people wash out of basic training for, first term enlistment, et cetera like that. And this gets, I think, to the economist model. I know it's a long question, short answer, but it's actually something that's actually a great application of mission command. People think it's only going to war. No, understand, visualize, describe, exploit the initiative, et cetera. What do you think the number one issue is why people attrit out of basic training? You probably read the articles, so don't tell them. Yeah, medical. Musculoskeletal issues. Musculoskeletal issues is our number one problem why people don't complete basic training. In fact, the problem we're getting is because so many people grow up sitting on a couch doing this, you know, their whole lives, is we get them in basic training and they literally are snapping in half. Okay, their hips are snapping in half. We put a rucksack on them and we break. And once you snap somebody in half, guess what? You now own the medical reparation for that for the rest of their life. So what we're saying is, hey, can I screen people better before I get them in the Army? That maybe, so everyone's talking about cognition, but I'm telling you that it's all about defining the problem. The big problem is the physical aspect. That's the vast majority of the people that don't complete out of basic training is musculoskeletal issues. Can I screen them better? And then, can I prepare them better? So what we've done is we started a pilot, come up with a visualization, how you do it, down at Fort Benning where all our infantry and armor soldiers go, and it's called iPrep, and they have two, and we screen people coming in, and then we take 2 extra weeks, we're sort of having to consume this out of hide with drill sergeants and everything like that, and we put them through, we work with our Surgeon General, a very progressive, medically sound, physiological process to improve everything from bone density, giving them special vitamins, et cetera like that, types of exercise that do not lead to repetitive injury kind of things, et cetera like that, and what we're finding is the folks that, as we screened them initially, had the lowest potential, say physically, to complete basic training. Once we put them through this preparation phase and really apply a little bit of science to them, they're graduating at a rate 75% higher than the folks that screened out higher initially when they came in the Army. So what we're saying is, you know what I think I'd like to do? This extra 2 weeks of preparation time here that I was just giving to people that screened out lower, what if I could give it to everybody in the Army? It increased my graduation rate, reduced the amount of people that I'm snapping in half or breaking, and therefore reduce the overall number of people that I have to recruit in the Army, therefore reduce the size of recruiting command, therefore reduce the size of people that go in the VA, et cetera, like that. And so when I lay this out, then I go to my friends up in the Army staff, the vice chief and the chief staff of the Army, I say, but there are costs with this. You know, that's 2 more weeks of basic training, so I need more drill sergeants. I need four more battalions of basic training because everything is, you know, in scale of the Army. In other words, there's initial cost. But again, understanding the problem now, lay this out and say, but in the end, I could save the cost down the road multiple years. But here's the deal. This kind of gets back to capabilities versus things. When you focus on things, you bin costs in budgets by things. And then what happens is you don't really know how much things cost because nobody pays for the whole capability. You only pay for part of it. So I'm saying I need more money for basic training. They're like, just like Perkins, always asking for more. That's his problem. I say, yeah, but you know, Surgeon General, this is going to save you money 10 years from now. Hey, look, I'm not going to be Surgeon General in 10 years. Actually, Patty Rojo is a great supporter of this. But I'm saying we've got to back up, folks. Stop looking at things like this. Look much longer term. So back to this recruiting issue, in a macro sense, what I would like to do is screen better, screen further to the left before we get them in the pipeline, and then be able to actually have access to them before they sign on the dotted line. There's legal issues with that and medical liability, but we think we can then get at psychological testing, which has a lot of HIPAA privacy issues like that. But I'm a big fan of screening more and screening them earlier and providing preparation, because one of the problems we're finding is the delta between society in the Army and the military in general, the delta between the physical requirements, the emotional requirements, the psychological requirements, the values, the delta is getting larger and larger and larger. And as we bring people out of society and bring them into the Army, that gap we have to close between their physical capability, their emotional, their psychological, that gap is becoming more and more difficult to deal with because of just unfortunately, some dysfunctional aspects in our society. And so I'm looking at it holistically that I think there are better ways for us to go about that. So the article is exactly on it, and we are trying to get after it. And quite honestly, I'm getting great support from the leadership of the Army because they see this as well, because the demographics is not getting any better. So I've got to really, I have to reduce attrition and better prepare soldiers. Great question. Yes.
General Lieutenant Commander Rob Hamilton, my question is specific to the mission command that you discussed earlier.
Yeah.
My question is this. You spoke early on about the importance of common understanding and common terminology
right.
of joint force. So how do you bridge those gaps when you make a change to something so foundational as command and control?
Yeah.
To create a common understanding for the joint force going forward?
So when we put out the Army operating concept, the first places we went is, at that time, Chief of Staff of the Army is General O'Dearno. General O'Dearno and I personally went to see the CNO and the Navy staff and laid out our Army operating concept and what it was and what it meant, everything. Then we went and saw General Walsh and he and the Air Force staff and talked through him. General Dumford, when he was a commandant of the Marine Corps, came down to TRADOC and spent a whole day there as we kind of talked through it. Went in brief General Dempsey, when he was the chairman at the time, and the J-7, and General Dempsey was a big fan of it. Now he's a former TRADOC commander, so, you know, I'm sure there's a little, you know, parochialism there. And then we briefed Secretary Carter right after he became the secretary. And so the first people we reached out to were the joint community and talked through, and none of the Joint Chiefs of Staff had any pushback on it. What they all wanted to know was, okay, how can we partner with you? What are the forms we have to kind of move this forward? So that before we even published it, we went to every joint chief personally, myself and the chief of staff of the Army, including the secretary of defense and the chairman, and described our visualization of what we were trying to do and why we wanted to do it, and described our understanding of the future and said, so if you think the future is not going to change, if you think the rate of change is going to slow down, then maybe we ought to stay with command and control. Okay, because I will tell you, if you have a known future with a known enemy with a slow rate of change, this ain't the book for you. This is the wrong doctrine. This is the wrong concept to deal with a steady state world. It just is. It is not optimized for that. But we're kind of banking that the world is going to change quicker and quicker and quicker, and it's going to be harder and harder and harder to try to predict which way it's going to go. So that's what we're banking on. That's the risk we're taking, that the rate of change is going to continue to increase quicker and quicker, And the ability to foresee what's going to happen is going to get less and less and less. And that's what this is for. So we kind of laid that out to all the Joint Chiefs and, quite honestly, did not get any pushback. So we are working actually very intently at that level. This is just one of the areas, quite honestly, that the Army felt so passionate about it. And we think in many ways it affects the human dimension of war so significantly, because we're not kind of a thing-centric force, that it probably maybe affects us at least as much as anybody else. So we've decided to seize, retain, and exploit the initiative. Okay. But great question. Yeah, other question. Yeah, right here.
Sir, Randy White, I was wondering if you could talk about how the reduction in the size of the Army has impacted your ability to build the Army, and how the size of the force goes with the capabilities to your concepts, et cetera.
Yeah, so that comes up a lot. Hey, do you guys have the slide that has air, land, battle and the Army operating concept side by side? If you could throw that up. So I get that a lot, resourcing, and in fact, Provost and I were just talking about, you know, rumors of budget deals and various like that. So it's always on our tips of our mind. So this was on 100-5. This is the manual I grew up with, 100-5, air, land, battle. I said if you were standing in the fold of the gap looking east, it would look eerily similar to this. So when I brief this to folks and I'm sort of comparing a known problem set to an unknown problem set, I get this question, resources. Wow, Perkins, you know what? That looks a hell of a lot more expensive than that. Are you going to be able to afford that? And what I tell them is, there's a difference between capability and capacity. What we're saying is, if we are down to one platoon in the Army, even if we are down to one platoon, which I think is unlikely, but whatever size the Army is, we're going to say it's going to have the capability to do that. It's going to do that. The issue is, how often can it do it? Over what area? Can it do it in one city block, in one continent, multiple continents, once every year, once every other year, three times simultaneously, et cetera, like that? It's very much, I think, analogous to sort of a carrier analogy. You know, you have an aircraft carrier which has capabilities. How many you have then gets you into your capacity, but you don't, you know, each one is designed a certain way to be able to launch planes, et cetera, like that, irrespective of how many other ones. You're not like, well, we don't have enough money, so none of them are going to be able to retrieve planes. They're just all going to launch planes. No, what we're saying is, even if we get down to one unit in the Army, it's going to have the capability to do that. The capacity issue then becomes a resourcing issue. You know, how, and then this gets back to the larger strategy, our national military strategy, our security strategy. Okay, how often do you want to do this? How much risk do you want to take? In the end, it's all about risk. How much risk are you willing to take? Where are you going to take it? And then how do you mitigate it? I mean, that's what senior leaders get paid to do. That's really all we do. I find as I continue to get promoted in the Army, besides people questioning the effectiveness of our promotion system, I find that I just get asked to take more and more risk. When I was a second lieutenant, they're like, hey, Perkins, Dr. Lee, you're supposed to have 1,500 meters, you have 1,500 meters. Supposed to have five tanks, you have five tanks. Supposed to have four person tank, you have four. In other words, we've given you everything you need, Perkins. We're just telling you, I'm going to tell you what to do. I control your compliance. You just do it. I'm not really asking you to take a lot of risks. From then on, it was like, you know what? You're supposed to have this, but you only have this. The guy before you had to control this much space, you have to control this much space. The only difference is you have less people. On and on and on and on. And they're saying, look, Perkins, we're just asking you to take risk. You have to understand the risk, visualize how you can mitigate it, describe to me how you're going to mitigate it, and then direct people to do that. And so that's what force structure does, is it determines how much risk you want to take and what's your overall capacity. But the capability, if you go to the one blow-up slide with some of those first order principles, we're saying we're going to have that capability in the Army no matter how big the Army is. It is very important for us to delineate that, because otherwise people say, well, you're only going to pick a couple unless I get more money. And I say, no, we're designing the Army to do this. It's just a matter of how often and how many times we can do it. And quite honestly, you know what our mitigation strategy is? The joint force. So when we sit down and do that, say, you know what? I don't think the Army has capability. We don't have capacity for this. Let's give the Marines. Let's give the Navy. Let's give the Air Force. We have to do a much better job of that. I had a great discussion with General Dunford, who's still the commandant. We're like, look, we can't have like an Army JLTV and a Marine JLTV and all that. Look, we're just going to have one, and then we're just going to figure out it's not perfect for any one person, but then there's risk one way or the other. How do you mitigate it, et cetera? Because again, our asymmetric capability is our joint force. And so we work very hard to make sure we're not looking at this as an Army only problem, because generally how we look at mitigating the risks out there are via our joint capabilities, because that does give us multiple options for the commander and multiple dilemmas for the enemy. Questions? Yes.
Is there Jim Forbes from the Army staff talking about the inter-service rivalries? They got three words that get your thoughts on. Air-sea battle.
Yeah. So air-sea battle is a great discussion of a tactical exchange of firepower. Okay, it's a battle. Okay, so I don't have any disagreement with any of the tenets of it. You just have to understand what I say. The first thing that I have to do is ask big questions. Okay, that is a tactical answer to a tactical problem. But then the next question is, okay, at the strategic level, how do I win? How do I consolidate gains in a sustainable manner? And how do I always stay in a position of relative advantage? So I think air-sea battle is a great intellectual way to think about a tactical exchange of firepower and how you're going to do it. What I'm saying is it just doesn't end there. Okay, you know, the most two disconcerting words in the English language are kind of like, now what? You know what I mean? Now what? Okay, believe me, the Iraq War, I was at the very beginning of the Iraq War, and I was at the very end of the Iraq War, and I was in the middle of it somewhere. And you know what the easiest thing was? To invade the country. That, I mean, I lost some great Americans in great heroic action, but invading a country was a lot easier, especially intellectually, than getting out of Iraq. Getting in Iraq was actually, you know, a tactical and operational exercise, and did that. Getting out of Iraq, that's now another question, because you want to get out in a way that you can sustain your gains, right? So air-sea battle is a great way to get into a fight. Other questions? Yes.
Captain Mary Beth Neal, United States Navy Medicine. Thank you for your presentation. I'm wondering if you had to assign a grade from your perspective at TRADOC and how well we incorporate lessons learned into informing doctrine and future capabilities. How are we doing and how can we improve?
How is TRADOC doing?
Yes, TRADOC, yeah. And then if you could parlay that to the joint force.
Yeah, well, I'll say we're 11 worth B. Okay, we're 11 worth B. Here's where we're not doing as well at. Our systems do tend to be very focused tactically and operationally. Lessons learned of counter IED, et cetera, because rightly so, we were losing great Americans. So everyone kind of focused on that. And so it's, how do we deal with tactical and operational issues? And so we're doing probably pretty well on that. The strategic area, that's very difficult. And quite honestly, as GIFCOM went away, I think there was a little bit of a void in that area. So I think there's a challenge with regards to how we're organized, because you know the Army really shouldn't be doing like its own strategic lessons. I mean, that clearly is all elements of national power. So we're not really organized to do that. We really don't have an organization. It is a coalition of the willing. And the second thing is strategic lessons learned. You got to be careful before you jump to conclusions, because those things take a long time to run out. An IED, that's pretty much immediate feedback. Okay, did I defeat the IED or not? I pretty much know right away whether it went off or not. So tactical operational lessons learned have a little, excuse the pun, shorter flash to bang time. So I can determine whether or not it really was a lesson learned or a lesson noted, because I can see sort of immediate effects. The strategic aspect obviously has a longer flash to bang time, so that's a difficult problem. The other issue is there are so many players in that we don't really have a paradigm to get after. I'll tell you the one that I am focusing on inside of TRADOC in the Army that really never got looked at, and we looked at, excuse me, the operational lessons learned, Afghanistan, Iraq, stuff like that, and then here's our new doctrine to approve them. What I'm really interested in is institutional lessons learned. What are we not doing well in TRADOC in basic training? What are we not doing well at the War College or Command General Staff College? Are we increasing our rate of innovation? Is my POI updating quick enough to deal with the problems that I have? We don't do those lessons. So I mean, or we hadn't done them systemically. So we have the Army Warfighting Assessment that we do every 6 months out of Fort Bliss. We're now starting an IWA, Institutional Army Warfighting Assessment. We're doing a warfighting assessment at how good the institution is of the United States Army, which pretty much is TRADOC. How well are we adapting and innovating to keep up with the emerging threats and looking at it holistically? So tactical operation level, probably that's a strength because we are very good at looking at exchanging firepower, et cetera. Strategic level, very difficult because there's not really a good paradigm for it. And then the one that we're putting a lot of effort on because really hadn't got looked at much at all inside the Army is the institutional ability to adapt and innovate. Hey, folks, what I'm going to do, I know I'm running out of time. What I want to do is wrap up with one last thing. And we were talking before, and I understand, because I'm trying to do an IPB here and say, what do students ask a lot about? What's their hot button issues, everything like that? And there wasn't just one hot button issue, which I guess is a pretty good thing. That means you're curious and asking lots of different questions and keep the staff and faculty on their toes. But one thing they told me is that you're focusing a lot on ethics, profession, things like that. And the Army has been on this for a couple of years now. We have CAPE, which is part of TRADOC, Center for Army Profession and Ethics. And we put out a manual recently, like we do on everything, ADP and ADRP 1.0 called the Army Profession, if you can put that up there. And it talks about the Army Profession is really, it is the secret sauce or the glue of the United States Army, and I think of the joint construct, of the joint construct. So I said we're not interested in a list of things to buy to fight. I mean, we will buy something, so if you're an Army guy in the acquisition world, don't worry, we will buy something eventually. But that's not our primary focus, the list of things to buy. It is building the capability to win. And you saw some of those main capabilities, WMD, situational understanding, early entry, et cetera, like that. But the number one capability that we are focusing on, it is that capability of the leader. Leader development is our number one capability that we're focusing on because we think that is our hedge against an unchanged, a constantly changing future, is that we have well-trained, well-disciplined units and leaders. Because, again, if you don't have a well-trained and well-disciplined army, what do you do to that army? You control it, okay? If you have an ill-disciplined organization, you will not empower it. So if you want to empower an organization, you better make sure it's well-trained and well-disciplined and well-led. And since our aim is to empower the exploitation of initiative, we said the first thing we have to do is make sure we have a professional force. So we want to be able to win in a complex world, win at the strategic level, a world that's unknown, constantly changing, and unpredictable. To do that, we exercise mission command to seize, retain, exploit the initiative to always get to a position of relative advantage through the process of understand, visualize, describe, direct, lead, and assess. To exercise mission command, you must have a professional army or a professional military, because if you do not, you cannot exercise mission command. And if you cannot exercise mission command, then you cannot exploit the initiative. The best you can do is control compliance. And this was pointed out to me very emphatically by somebody who's not even in the U.S. Army, in fact, somebody who's not even a U.S. citizen. So I was in a bad part of the world where a lot of us have been, and I was an infantry division commander at the time and going around doing what we do with my counterpart who outranked me in this country, and we're trying to do various things like that. And I'm like, hey, we got to do combined arms this and this. And so, you know, typical sort of A-type personality of, you know, American officers, we're going to do this, good. And we were at lunchtime, and apparently I had reached the good idea cutoff point. And he said, okay, stop. Perkins says, you know, I've been watching you command this division here for a while, et cetera, like that. And, you know, I've come to the conclusion that you take being a general in the United States Army for granted. I said, what? I said, you're questioning the effectiveness of a promotion system that would select somebody like me to be a general officer? Get in line. No, that's not what I'm saying. He says, I've seen how you operate, and you take being a general in the U.S. Army for granted. And I said, what do you mean by that? And he says, well, because you get your fancy helicopter, and you fly off the 1st Brigade, and you tell them to do this, and you don't worry that when you leave, they're going to start a coup, okay? And you go down to 3rd Brigade and you give them new MRAPs and you don't worry that they're going to sell them on the black market. And you tell the Command Sergeant Major to get all the NCOs to do this. And you don't worry about that he's going to call his cousin in MOD and get you relieved or something like that. He says, you just trust everybody. He says, you are very naive. You naively trust everybody that what you tell them to do, they're going to do it. You trust their motivation. He says, in fact, I don't really see you, in his mind, I don't see you controlling very much at all. You know, you might be commanding, but you're not really controlling. And he said, the other thing is, as I go around your unit, it seems to kind of be on autopilot. It's self-policing. Because I watch your other brigades, and then this unit does something, and if there's a lieutenant not doing the right thing, the company commander kind of corrects him. Or if there's a sergeant not headed in the right direction, the platoon sergeant steps out, et cetera, like that, and you weren't even there. In other words, there were things going on that weren't right in your unit, and then I saw other leaders in that unit kind of get it going in the right direction, and you weren't in there. So what he was saying is, Perkins, I don't know what you really do. I don't really know what you do as a division commander. You just go around, flying around, telling people to do stuff. You assume they're all going to do it. You assume they're not going to turn on you. All kinds of stuff's going on, and you are nowhere near. What he was saying is, Perkins, you're not really that good. You're not really that good because, see, you have a big problem. You have a big problem. You have a substance abuse problem in that if you don't get your daily fix of this, you can't command your division. Okay, you have a crutch. The only way, Perkins, that you could even attempt to do what you do as division commander is if you have a professional army. And what he was saying is, I don't. I don't have a professional army. I don't have an army that I can blindly trust everyone or that is self-synchronizing. So what he was saying is, Perkins, stop lecturing me. Because, see, the thing is, you are taking it for granted. You take the fact that you're a general officer in the United States military, and that you can blindly trust everyone, and that they will be self-correcting. And oh, by the way, I've seen your division in combat, and you know what? They do have a sense of something larger than themselves. They have a sense that they don't want to let their unit down, or they don't want to let the people to the left and right about them. It has nothing to do with their pay or anything like that. Again, I tell you, in the Army, we have a definition for everything. Esprit de corps, while it is manifested by company runs and T-shirts and all that, we define esprit de corps as a jealous regard for the honor of your unit. The Army definition for esprit de corps is a jealous regard for the honor of your unit. Are you acting in a way that you are displaying not just a somewhat whimsical regard, a jealous regard for the honor of your unit? Do you understand that people are looking at you and they are judging your unit based on how you operate? And are you doing so that you don't want to let that unit down, the honor of that unit down? And when I say unit, I mean this unit, and this unit. Because when you are out there, what we're telling our soldiers is you need to act as if what you do shows a jealous regard for the honor of the unit and those that you represent. And he said the other thing is, and it did happen to be an artillery unit, he says, I was up in the north and your soldiers were conducting counterinsurgency one day, and the next day they're firing artillery for a dismounted infantry attack. They're firing artillery, live artillery rounds over dismounted infantrymen. And they just went from one complex operation counterinsurgency to firing artillery, and again, Perkins, you were nowhere to be found. In fact, there wasn't even an officer there. It was not commissioned officers and soldiers. He says, so they all know what they're doing. They're experts at what they're doing. But the thing he said that amazed him the most is, where do you find these servicemen and women that are willing to travel thousands of miles away from home and, if possible, give their lives for people they don't even know when I can't even get my own army to defend its own country? So what he was saying is, Perkins, you're not that good. I don't need your lectures anymore about this or that because, see, you have a huge crutch, Perkins. In other words, you know, anybody could command an American infantry division if they had one of these. This is the key to success. I've been watching the American Army, and this is your secret sauce, okay? It's not any of your things. It's not your things. It's the capability that a group of professionals have when they come together and they are stewards of the profession. He said, in fact, this whole exercise has kind of been a giant bait and switch. Because you know what, Perkins? We bought your things. We bought your tanks. We bought your rifles. We bought your Humvees. And you know what? They don't do anything. They just sit there and rust. Because, see, you didn't sell us this. You didn't sell us this. We bought your things. What we failed to understand is that what we really needed were not things to fight, but a capability to win. And you don't get a capability to win unless you have professional soldiers, sailors, airmen, and marine that you can pair with things in formation to actually get the job done. And so it took somebody else, not even in the U.S. Army, but not even a U.S. citizen, to say, you know what? I've figured out what makes the Army so good, the U.S. military so good. You're building capability. You're not buying things. We thought the answer was to buy things. Because you know what? Most of those people, the first interface they had with the U.S. military was on the receiving end of our thing. And they said, you know what, that's a pretty powerful thing. I think I want one of those. What they didn't realize is the capability of the U.S. military, not our things. So as part of the whole joint force, folks, thanks for having a little bit of your time this afternoon, and thanks for being part of the capability to win. Thanks.